Hello, comrades, and welcome back to Shanka Show, stories about life in the Soviet Union. Здравствуйте, дорогие товарищи. В эфире программа Ушанка Шоу. So today we're going to continue analyzing this interesting document from KGB of Ukraine that was published in July of 1976. Of course, it was classified and was only addressed to the leaders of the Communist Party of Ukraine. This document was discovered by Ukrainian historian Eduard Andriushenko, and he's posting some of his finds on his YouTube channel called KGB Files. I already covered several pages of this report in my video 1976 KGB Report American Spies in Ukraine and Summer Olympics, and now we continue looking at the page number 4. There is a small chapter on this page called Об американской выставке, about American exhibition, Kyiv. Photography USA exhibition is still taking place in the city. I already made a video called Window into America 1976 Photography USA exhibition brochure, where I actually show the scans of that brochure. So it's kind of a unique opportunity for the Americans to see how America was represented to the Soviet citizens. An example like they show about photography in the United States. Photography USA or Фотография в США exhibition took place in 1976 and 1977. It was shown in the major Soviet cities, beginning with Kyiv in summer of 1976, Alma-Ata, Kazakhstan in October-November same year, then Tbilisi, Georgia, Ufa. In the summer of 1977, it was shown in Novosibirsk, Siberia, and then in Moscow, the capital of the Soviet Union. There were about 800 different photos displayed at this exhibition, and around 1.5 million Soviet citizens visited this Photography USA exhibition. Each visitor received this round badge called Фотография в США, the name and the logo of this exhibition. And interestingly enough, even 45 years later, 2021 minus 1976, it's 45 years. Some people still keep that badge. Also, each visitor received this colorful brochure called Фотография в США once again, Photography in the USA. And not many of those remained intact. First of all, a lot of people complained that, you know, their friends and relatives wanted to read it too. And of course, it went around and got ripped in pieces. And also, there were quite a few pictures of pretty American girls that bus drivers were cutting out and attaching them. It was kind of a popular thing to do, to put pictures of the pretty girls on the windshield on your bus or trolley bus. So that's what happened to some of those pictures. Meanwhile, many Soviet schoolgirls used this exact photo. I believe this is American potato salad. They used it as a cover for their cooking notebooks. If you watch my videos about Soviet education, you should be familiar that back in the Soviet days, we used to have so-called уроки труда, labor lessons, and girls were studying separately from boys, and we were learning how to fix shit, and girls were learning how to cook and fix clothes and do stuff like that. And some lucky visitors, not many, managed to get a free Polaroid shot done by this long-haired dude. His name was John. We'll talk about him later, and they still keep those pictures with them till now. John the American was using Polaroid SX-70, which was introduced back in 1972 at the cost of $180 and $6.90 for each film pack of 10 pictures. Adjusted to inflation, it's $1,114 per camera and $43 per 10 pack of pictures. Quite pricey. So yeah, that camera was very popular, and Polaroid sold 700,000 of them by mid-1974. According to a witness from Novosibirsk who visited this exhibition in summer of 1977, people were also treated with Coca-Cola. So who was behind this exhibition, Фотография в США? It was USIA, United States Information Agency, Информационное агентство Соединенных Штатов. USIA was created in 1953 by executive order of President Eisenhower. During the Cold War, at its peak, it was the largest government PR company of the world, with budget over $2 billion and around 10,000 employees. Using modern terminology, USIA was a content creator. They created anti-Soviet propaganda, that they pushed through the radio station Voice of America. If you want to learn more about so-called enemy voices, вражеские голоса, you can check out my video called Struggle Against the Fake News and the Enemy Voices in the USSR, Propaganda Wars. USIA also published a Russian language magazine called America, that was distributed in the Soviet Union, although I never had a chance to even see this magazine. It was in such a high demand, it was deficit, and it was intended to inform Soviet citizens about American life. It was published from 1944, and the last issue was published in 1994. Fun fact, United States Information Agency was specifically forbidden from domestic dissemination activities, according to Zorinsky Amendment. And Zorinsky, he was actually a son of the Russian Jewish immigrants. So Voice of America could do propaganda all over the world except in its own country. United States Information Agency was dismantled and shut down in 1999 during Bill Clinton administration. Okay, now let's go back to our KGB document when they talk about this American exhibition in Kyiv, Photography USA.
Photography USA exhibition is still taking place in the city. According to operational data, exhibition organizers provide daily instructions to the staff, guiding them to activate propaganda treatment of the Soviet citizens.
The guides, so this is the Americans that worked at the exhibition, receive briefings based on the materials from the Voice of America broadcasting. Discussions are being held based on the selected articles from the Soviet newspapers. The guys are not allowed to purchase our newspapers, which means Soviet newspapers, and give their friends phone numbers at the hotel. This is interesting detail. So sounds like they knew that most Soviet hotels had listening devices. So they said, don't give your friends your phone numbers and don't chat on the phones. In case of any contacts with the Soviet citizens, they are required, the guides, to provide detailed reports to their management. During the performance of the operative actions, so that's interesting, so there's оперативные действия, so that's what KGB people were working. Several Soviet citizens were discovered that they were attempting to contact the Americans with criminal intent. Quite interesting, criminal intent. In the following, there are several examples of such a attempts to contact the Americans with criminal intent. On July 18, Comrade Shabarov from the city of Gorky, which is renamed again to Nizhny Novgorod, and that's far away, it's 800 miles from Kyiv, about 20 hours by train. So this guy traveled all the way from Gorky to Kyiv and to attempt to contact these Americans at the exhibition. This guy was born in 1945, so at that moment, in 1976, he was 31 years old, with unfinished college degree, и, once again, без определенных занятий, without specific place of work. So here we go again. United States, Soviet Union had 100% employment, no unemployment, but we had people без определенных занятий. So there were people that didn't have a specific place of work, but they were never called unemployed. It was really, kind of funny, kind of not. So this person was known to the KGB as a person with traitor's intents. It was discovered, once again, by this оперативным путем, that Shabarov was trying to convince the American lady to enter into the fictitious marriage with the purpose of him moving to the United States. So he got caught doing it, and information about Shabarov's actions were forwarded to the Gorky KGB office. So the guy was trying to live the Soviet Union through marriage, and he traveled by train for 20 hours one way to attempt to do that. On July 22nd, Comrade Adamovich from Kyiv, that's a local guy, born in 1939, so he was 37 years old, at that time engineer, previously worked at the Research Institute of Material Problems, currently not working anywhere, once again unemployed, known to the KGB as an anti-Soviet person. That's fairly impressive. So this guy approached the KGB operational source, which is to call it Operativный источник. So this is the person who worked at this exhibition, but he was a KGB agent, cleaning lady, or someone else. So he looked as an American, but he wasn't. So this engineer approached him, thinking he was a member of exhibition staff, and handed to him a personal request to be given to the United States Embassy with a request for help to move to the United States and utilizing his technical development solutions. So this engineer had some designs that he wanted to utilize in America. And KGB continues to document Adamovich's hostile activities. When I read this, I was like, this poor bastard. You know, he's approaching this guy, thinking he's an American, and he was a KGB agent. So it's impressive that they managed to even act and look like a exhibition staff, but they were KGB. And this part about the exhibition in Kiev ends was KGB of Ukraine, together with party organs, takes measurements to prevent actions of ideological sabotage coming from the exhibit staff. We continue to undertake operational actions to discover and stop any kind of reconnaissance, subversive and subversive activities. So in every Soviet city, Kiev, Almaty, Tbilisi, Novosibirsk, Moscow, that exhibition was swarmed with the local KGB agents. And of course, it makes me wonder how many Americans worked for example, CIA. According to Nathan Farb, the American photographer who was hired to be part of this exhibition, out of 40 guides, at least one was CIA for sure. And speaking of American guides, a lot of people who attended this exhibition, they mentioned this long-haired American who was taking Polaroid pictures and giving away those Polaroid shots. And his name was John Bailey. And I discovered that he originally from Muskegon, Michigan, so it's my neighbor. He went to college in Grand Rapids, and later he became an U.S. ambassador in Russia, and he worked as an ambassador from 2008 till 2012. So that famous Polaroid guy from the Photography USA exhibition of 1976 was a future ambassador in Russia. Okay, my friend, that's all I have for you today. I'm not done with this 1976 KGB document. There's more pages to translate and discuss, but we're done at least with this exhibition part. As always, subscribe, like this video, share with your friends, comment, and we'll talk to you soon. До свидания. Goodbye. By the way, cool merch for cool comrades is available at the Ushanka store at teespring.com. Just a friendly reminder that my book American Diaries is available on amazon.com, or shoot me an email if you would like to have a signed copy. Thank you! And if you love my channel and would like to show your support, Please click on the link below this video and become the patron of the Ushanka Show. For as little as $1, you can help us grow and create the new interesting videos about the life in Soviet Union.